almost all behavior analytic interventions run contrary to your instinct. That's the hardest part.
A couple of years ago, I was working with a family and the mom told me she had like five kids and dad worked a ton. I think he worked overnight, so he wasn't home. And like all five kids were in her bed with her. And I was like, that needs to stop. So I wind up staying. I was like, I'll sleep in the hallway. Like I will literally set up shop in the hallway. And if those kids come out of the room, getting through me before, you know, before you disrupt mom's night of sleep. And I remember the next day, mom was like, oh my God.
Yeah.
She's like a new person. I was like, I mean, I slept great too. I'm glad because I guess the kids didn't get past me.
it's the hardest thing to do, to listen to your child cry and things like that. And especially if your child has a developmental delay and autism, things like that, you're adding significantly harder. So you can understand, you have the empathy for these parents who are going through this.
Yep.
Anyone who has kids gets it, right?
You get it. It changes your view a little bit on
I didn't step in the hallway, but I did help out a parent who I was doing a home program for. It was all attention. He would actually hold his bowels all day until she put him to bed, and he would fecal smear because he knew that would get mom in there. And it went on and on and on. Like it's.
He's finger painting all over.
Finger painting.
Because somehow she reinforced the most intense behavior and she did a nice job ignoring the low intensity ones, right? This video, this tonight can serve as birth control.
I used to say those things.
Yeah, sorry, Andrea.
And I'll say too, if you think about sleep as behavior, because it's behavior, right? That man can't do it, why?
Yep.
All these providers always say, no, we can't.
Yeah, but why?
So the funder, I don't know. So I think maybe it's part funding, maybe it's just like that last taboo place, like we won't go there overnight or whatever.
But Mark Mintz was big on that, the neurologist out of CNNH. He's big on, you know, sleep impacting behavior. It's huge. What sucks is if it is medical later, like I felt guilty as shit because Olivia was crying and a lot and she couldn't get out of bed at that infant age and it was, you know, me and Chris were like ignoring her, like, yeah, we're great babies. and then took her to a GI doctor and she had like severe reflux. And then we found out all we had to do was give her this like kid version of Prevacid and then sit her upward, a little upright, and she stopped, and we felt like shit. Like we were like, we're ignoring our child.
Sure. But any of our interventions, we always say we need to rule out medical.
Yeah. So you'd rule out all the medical. If there was some true medical need, then you wouldn't do something like this. It's proven to be a behavior.
I think my wife is the biggest variable when it comes to the sleep because of the emotions, like you said.
Yeah. Oh,
she
yeah.
gets it. I finally got her to buy into the science.
You know you're on camera.
But
yeah. I love sure this
but that's what it is with all parents and attention and working with mothers and some get it, but it's the emotion.
It is.
You can't just turn it off. We are human beings.
You're not a mom.
Right.
That comes first. You're just like, you know what, this is my child.
And because I always say almost all behavior analytic interventions run contrary to your instinct.
Mm-hmm. Right.
That's the hardest part.
Sure, that's a really good point.
Almost all behavior analytic interventions that involve any form of extinction, escape extinction, tangible extinction, sensory, they all run against your DNA because you want to console. And at what point though, when a baby can't communicate, that's the hard part. When a baby can't communicate, and what age is it that you finally start reinforcing DRA, like appropriate communication, as opposed to the crying? So there's no clear line when you start, you know, because as a mom or as a dad, especially the mom, you're reinforcing because you have to offer a whole bunch of things to the baby because they can't communicate, and you're offering everything you can. Number one, out of negative reinforcement, say stop crying. And two, because you out of compassion, knowing they want something, but you can't communicate what. So at what age do you finally start saying, wait a second, this is a behavior issue? You know what I mean?